tiger on the prowl. I'ma make it go wild. I'm original, and I told you so. I'm a kid in the candy store with the leather on the denim. I ain't the cure, I'm the venom. If you wanna find me, find the taillight. Something's coming in, you're gonna wanna take a red eye. It's time to go. It's time to go. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Don't blink, don't blink. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Don't blink, don't blink. I don't wait for nobody. I'ma sign my name on the dotty. City lights call my name, drawn to the flame, and I'm feeling kinda naughty. I hit the ground running, step out the door and I'm stunning. Better hold tight, cause you know what's going down. I'm setting the pace, cause this is my town. So get ready. Get ready. Get ready.
Wednesday, Keely Dunn here, FH Umpires. So good to see you all. We took last week off so that we could make space and support Hannah Harrison and Dan Barstow doing their talk for England Hockey. And I'm recharged. I'm ready to go. I can't wait for the show because we are going to talk about the big thing that happened this weekend. I don't know if you heard about it. There was just like this minor thing that happened end of the game in Dutch Hoofdklasse, and it was a penalty corner, and it was a bully, and it was tears, and wow. So we are going to sort through that today. We are going to walk through it in excruciating detail. It's going to be a blast. I can't wait. I'm such a nerd. And once we do that, if we have any time, look, I literally said, yeah, this is probably going to take an hour. Probably. We're going to sort through that. We have got some really, really like mind-blowing stuff to talk about that comes out of that, not directly applicable to that situation, but a bombshell and what I have decided to dub the Pibworth rule. That's right. Luke, I'm going to make you famous right here, right now, happening on the internets, because you got to get your flowers for this. Anyway, it's so exciting. You can tell I'm just vibrating. So we're going to do all that. It's probably going to take an hour, maybe an hour, 15 minutes. Then I got a couple goalkeeper collisions, you know, goalkeepers doing goalkeeper things, whatever. And we'll work through a couple scenarios if we have time. But man, it's going to be so good. What else do we want to talk about? Before I say hi to everybody, just a couple quick announcements. I would like to give some congratulations. First of all, let me say a warm welcome to Top Secret. I can't tell you who this person is, but there is a new joiner in the FHU 13 Yellow membership, and I'm very happy to have this person, but I can't tell you who they are. I'm just saying. So, warm welcome. But flowers also go to this fantastic human being right here, Liz Spencer. I'm so proud of you. You and I had a conversation at the beginning of the season, maybe 2 months ago now, and we talked about your goals, we talked about where you were going and how hard you've been working to get right here where you are, National League at level 3, England, MPUA. So, well done. I'm really, really happy for you. If anybody else out there, part of the third team, whether you are on the Discord server or not yet, look, I mean, it's possible. Maybe you just haven't signed up yet. I don't know where you are, like, where you be at. Come on, get your life together. Get your life together and get on the Discord. It's right here. FHumpires.com/Discord. Come over and say hi to everybody. If you're there, if you're just somebody who shows up for this live stream, maybe this is your first time. Maybe this is it. Oh my God, what a day. What a day. 50th show, and this is going to be your first time on this live stream. Yo, props to you. Please say so in the comments, and we will give you the proper FHU13 welcome. And if something great's happened to you recently, let's talk about it because I'm in a great mood. Let's do this. Okay, let me say hi to everybody because it's my favorite thing. And oh man, I was absolutely spitting my tea earlier at a couple of these comments. So Rachel, as always, fantastic to have you. Bonus point, Simon, for the first comment and the drinks list. I love that about you guys. We all have our own things. We do our things and we support each other in the things. So great stuff. I am also drinking tea today. I drank wine on Friday. All the wine. And I'm now drinking tea for a few weeks. Just saying. It was one of those. Let's see. Okay, this one, Gideon. I tell you, Professor, you kill me. Like, this is so good. Not sure if you require retake or of a PC or a bully or just a stream of ill-informed and aggressive tweets. Look, it really wasn't that bad. It wasn't that bad. But I do want to talk about that. I want to talk about when we go on to this PC from the Hooved Claw. So we're going to talk about why it got so big and why there are 14 articles on hockey.nl about this one decision that was, spoiler alert, completely correct. Lou, always good to have you. A Bavarian lager. Nice. Nicely played. Paul, you know, even today, I'm not mad because I'm in a great mood. And it's going to be great to see on the replay squad. We have talked about what you have to do on the replay squad. You have to go in the comments. You got to go hashtag replay squad. And then you have to basically live tweet the whole thing and comment at me as if you're in the live broadcast. Because it's hilarious. I do that all the time on YouTube to drive my friends crazy. And it's fun. And yes, sir, this is the man of the hour, Mr. Pibworth. We are going to talk about the Pibworth rule. And that's why it's going to be such a good one. And yeah, okay. Thank you. You didn't have to, but you're right. They are all good. Nah, he had it. He had it all the way. And oh, here's my friend Callie. Good to see you, friend. From the live stream community. And I tell you, I do not ask them to show up. I'm very much like, hey, I do this thing, but that thing is over there and it's all about hockey and it's all about rules and you probably have zero interest in it. So I don't, like, you know, I'll see you elsewhere. And then they show up here and it's really nice. It's nice to see encouraging, supportive faces. So thank you. Guess who went to the salon yesterday? It would be this girl right here. There you go. Sam Church. Hey, friend. Mr. National League. Good to have you. Yurian's here as well. Good to see you. It's been a couple days. Stain. Yes. Okay. Like, Stain, he's got a nose for the controversy. He shows up for the streams when he knows that there's going to be something big. There you go. Godders. The subject has caused chaos online. Yeah, Godders was part of at least one of the Twitter threads that I got pulled in on and refused to let go of. Godders, we can talk about this later as well. And a Kia Ora to you too, Stefan. Very nice to have you. Yeah, of course, you know, Aline, you are in the middle of the action over there. And Scott Riley, good to have you. Look, we know. Stop bragging, okay? We know that it's the best league in the world. I'm just kidding. Mr. Barlow, hello, friend. By the way, the latest Hockey World news. Thank you. This is a very good point that I should have added into my pre-show. That Mr. Milford is pointing out that moderator, FHU 13 extraordinaire, person of all talents, Katarina De Santos, wrote a really nice article about Tomas Brill on his retirement in the Hockey World News. And there's another interesting article that I think Jade Bloomfield himself penned it. Jade doesn't come into this Discord server because he's not nice. I'm just saying. No, he's really busy. It's fine. He's just the editor of the Hockey World News and has a full-time job and, you know, umpires and plays and he does all these things. So I get it. But Jade, would you just get in the server? Anyway, he wrote a long article at the beginning of the Hockey World News about, well, rules and rule changes and stuff like that. And we might be able to talk about this next week or the week after, something like that. But today, something else. All right. Yeah, the internet exploded. It was crazy. Michael Vince, good to see you, friend. And Tomas. All right. This is great. So, who wants to talk some super nerdy rules things? Okay. Let me see if I've got this all. I set up my scenes very carefully. I'm relying on this to be all the things. So this is where it kind of kicked off, at least for those of us outside of the Netherlands. So those of us who weren't at the game, who weren't watching the game, and perhaps in the English-speaking world, this is sort of how it happened, because GB in England international Sean McCallan issued this tweet on Hallows Eve. And she, in this tweet, she described, so she pulled this, she screenshot her text to make sure that her tweet would have all of the things in it. And yeah, if you haven't seen it, we can summarize the events. This is fairly accurate, except not entirely. So from Shauna's explanation, she was on the Oranje-Rood team, as we'll be able to see because her astonished face appears in one of the photos of the articles. And we're dealing with Victoria's up 2-1. Oranje-Rood is up 2-1. And they have given up a penalty corner at near the end of the game. And in the course of that corner, time expires. So we are now in extra time. When this, you know, extra time, if that's not even a real term, but let's just say it is. And the controlling umpire, whose name is Barry, very young, very, very well-spoken young man, as we're going to see later on. He believes he sees a foot and immediately calls a PC. He hears the protestations of the of the Oranje-Rood defense, that it actually hit the defender's hand. He consults with his buddy. Maybe one of the Dutch speakers can help me with the proper pronunciation of his name. Where is it? I've got it. But I'm always concerned I'm going to, yes. Armand, okay. Armand, I hope it's not Armand, or I'll call him Armand for now and you can tell me if I'm wrong. Goes to consult with Armand. It's only a hand. And because the hand is part of the stick, there's no foul. So the PC has been interrupted for no reason that would ordinarily end a PC. And Barry, in his inexperience, believes that the penalty corner is over and makes a signal as such. Quickly realizes that that's not true. And when you watch the video, which we're going to watch in a sec, I have suspicions that actually some of the Victoria players know the rule, which if you do, if you're a Victoria player and you knew the rule and you went to Armand and you were telling him, dude, like, this is incorrect, that can't be right, you let me know and I will send you a really nice bottle of wine because you need to be rewarded for this behavior. No question about it. Like, that is a mammoth achievement because nobody in the rest of the world knows this rule. Sorry. I got this. So the correction is made. Because a bully cannot end a PC, the PC must be restarted. The PC is then played out. Victoria scores, ties the game. Oranje-Rood now goes from earning 3 points and breaking a very long losing streak in the Hoofd Klasse. I think 20 games they had lost in a row, had fired their coach. This was the first game for the new coach, and they end up with a tie. So that's the scenario as we know it. So let's just have a look at the video quickly. We've met. And we will see what we can see. Okay, the sound is really terrible, so I will turn it on, but only once. For atmosphere. So you can hear all the cheering. So at this point comes the consultation. Barry goes to Armand, and they're going to have a little chat about the initial call. This is when Oranje-Rood starts to celebrate because they believe that they have won the game. Further consultation happening right now. Penalty corner given. And you can see Barry's under some... Sorry, I can't stand it. It's in my brain. You can see Barry's under quite a bit of pressure from the Oranje-Rood players at this moment, and he's explaining to them, as Armand is explaining to another player further up the pitch, as you can see this way, what the rules are. The explanation is not going all that well at the moment, to put it mildly, but the players then go back to defend the penalty corner. Still more discussions. I think that might be the captain. Not entirely sure. And now the defenders are getting set up. And we are going to play out the last... We are going to play out the corner. Now, you can see that the clock at the top is winding. They haven't stopped at any point, so it's a little bit unclear of some things. But the most important points that we know are... that time expired before Barry called the reaward of the penalty corner for the supposed foot. And then this is the subsequent PC. The sound isn't even in time with the video. So they score. And I mean, you can, once you read the articles and everything, you can tell that there's just a ton of emotion on the field. It was very intense. This is an article that was translated. So Jade posted this in the Hockey World News. It's a translation in English of the hockey.nl article about all of it, and it's a fairly accurate reflection, but maybe not entirely. But you can see the really intense emotion on the players' faces, and you can see more tears here, the elation of the coach who thinks that they have won. You can't change your mind. The game is over, says the Australian physical trainer, Matt Ailes. We will talk about this in a moment as well, because we're going to go through this. There is much chaos. This is the photo that I was talking about, where you can see McCallum and the captain, where there would have been a lot of conversation and all that. And I'm just going to read this, and obviously this is translated. So this isn't, I mean, it's not great English, and maybe there's some misinterpretations of words. But the captain here, I just don't believe what happened. Suddenly it turns out there's a miraculous rule that no one has ever heard of. The umpires explained it to me, but I still don't really get it. If it's not a penalty corner, then the game is over, right? Because the horn is already gone and we can't play a bully anymore, Victoria gets a penalty corner. What a crooked rule. Sorry to say it, but you get screwed in front of you. That's how it feels to us, she says. Okay. So, hopefully that gives you a really good breakdown of factually what occurred. We can go back to the video at any point and go through the scenario again to make sure that everybody's in agreement. I made sure that before I really, 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 really made up my mind as to things that I wanted to see the actual match footage to make sure that the reaward came before the horn and or came after the horn and all this kind of stuff. Anyway, but I was quite satisfied with all that. Before I start analyzing the rules, I'm just going to have a couple of peeps at who's here. Okay, Roger Addison's here. Yes, Jade does have lots on his plate. He's moving countries, so there you go. Jack's here. Hey, friend. Stefan has no drinks. Caffeine only. Oops, sorry. Make sure I get the right one up there. Yeah, you're right. No, see, Godders, it's for players. We know the rules, but when players do, or coaches... Paul, we're going to star this one because we're going to come back, because we are going to have a nice discussion once we have the whole rule, all the rules all wrapped up in a bow and we understand exactly what had occurred. We're going to talk about whether this rule is fair or not, and we're going to talk about how do you handle this better as an umpire. Okay, so that's a really... really good one. And Kelly, who knows nothing about hockey, is saying, dang, that's intense. Yes, it was. It was very intense for the players. I need to remember to couch everything that I say. I am a coach now, currently, and very close to players. I'm very well acquainted with losing. I know how it feels. I do not coach in the Hauptklasse. I don't play in the Hauptklasse. I don't know what that's like. So we as umpires still need to pay attention to and invest in our empathy for players in how we handle the proper application of the rules. That being said, it doesn't change the proper and correct application of the rules. So here's the first rule that we, dang it, need to remind ourselves about, okay? This is rule 13.5 that dictates when a penalty corner is completed. Now you're going to look at this and you say, but Keely, you know, this doesn't say anything about bullies anymore. And I will say, you are absolutely correct. This is how 13.5 reads in the most recent edition of the 2019 rulebook, which was issued in January of this year. That's important. Okay. You can see that there's a little black stroke mark at the side there. That indicates something has changed. So that's what we call blacklining. And in legal documents, that is to indicate something is different in this from the last time you saw it, the last edition, the last publication of this law, this rule book, this whatever. So something has been removed. And what has been removed is not that one. Let's try this way. Because it's not going to behave for me. Nope. Not that either. This is great. You know, sometimes I set up things and they get confused. And then sometimes everything works really well. So I'm going to go manual. Okay. This is what 13.5 read up until January. And this is what the current rules app from the FIH reads. There is that sub G, that the penalty corner is completed when a bully is awarded, except if the play is stopped because of an injury or for any other reason during the taking of a penalty corner at the end of a quarter and a bully would otherwise be awarded, the penalty corner must be taken again. Okay? So there was a lot of discussion over the last few days about how, oh, the rules app isn't up to date and you got to go to the PDF to get the real version and all that kind of stuff. But you know what? It doesn't change a thing whether you're going off the November 2020 version of the 2019 rules of hockey or you're going off the January 2021 rule version of the 2021 rules of hockey. This is going to be so complicated to talk about. Okay. And this is what it looked like as well, in case you weren't sure, in the November 2020 version. It also looked like this when the 2019 rules were first issued. But you know what? This is nowhere near a new rule. This has been in the rule book in some form or another. This is 2000. This is the 2000 iteration of the rules. Okay. I wonder if this is the right. Oh no, sorry. Yeah, this is the 2000 because I was just going to show you. There we go. Sorry. So 2000 read that and it didn't talk about a bully, but 2002. Yeah, 2002. So this whole idea that a bully cannot end a penalty corner in extra time has been in place since 2002. For sure. Almost two decades of this rule being there. So if you call that a miraculous rule, maybe the Dutch word translated into something else. It was more like unusual or rare or whatever, because this rule actually hasn't been, doesn't get invoked very often. But the other corresponding part of the rule book that we need to look at is this, which is 6.5. Okay, and 6.5 deals with bullies. How do you do a bully? When do you do a bully? And as you can see, there's the magic black line indicating something has changed. This is new in the January edition of the rule book. Sub D, in the case of an award of a bully at a penalty corner without any of the conditions of 13.5 A to F not being completed, then the penalty corner is retaken. So, for the most part, and we'll get onto the Pibworth rule in a moment, they've lifted 13.5 sub G and they have transported it into 6.5. Perhaps the rules committee believing that that would create better clarity because they're not saying this is when a penalty corner doesn't get stopped. It's an exception. And so why have an exception in a rule that explains when a penalty corner does end, when it is completed? I don't really know. And I have that in there twice. But this is how 6.5 read in November 2020. Okay? That guidance that is attached to sub D was not there. Okay. So hopefully we've all got a handle on this, that the conditions that occurred in that match, as that penalty corner was occurring, after the completion of time at the end of a quarter, in fact, at the end of the last quarter of the game, that that was a penalty corner that could not end with the award of a bully, that the penalty corner had to be retaken. End of story. Full stop. This is not negotiable, friends. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if we like this rule or not. We as umpires, we know that we don't get to pick and choose which rules we apply just because one team is on a 20-game losing streak and the other team is in the middle of the table. Because every rule affects two teams on the pitch. And one of the aspects of the discussion that I got in with a few people, including one certain person on Twitter who couldn't seem to get this through his head. You can certainly say that that feels unfair to the defending team because they haven't done anything wrong. But guess what? The attackers did nothing wrong either. And particularly in that situation, I can play the video again if you don't believe me, that it wasn't as though the penalty corner had been successfully defended, the ball had been cleared, all kinds of things, and then the decision to award the penalty corner came afterwards. The penalty corner was interrupted, which means the defenders didn't have an opportunity to fully defend that penalty corner, and the attackers didn't have a full opportunity to attack their penalty corner either. So that is why the rule is in place. Because it's not fair to the attack that because a dog runs onto the pitch or somebody gets injured off the ball, there's a head injury because two players collide and they bang their heads and boom, you got to stop play because concussions. Or, unfortunately, an umpire makes a decision that is incorrect to re-award a penalty corner and that was the incorrect decision. That is another ground for which a bully must be awarded because it stopped the penalty corner without any of the other conditions of 13.5 applying. Okay? Emotionally, we can have all kinds of sympathy for the defending team here. Absolutely. God, I mean, you can't look at all of this and not feel that as a human being, as a hockey fan, as somebody who loves the game, as we all do, okay? We can feel this. However, would it have been fair if in that moment, Victoria could have then collected the rebound off McKaylin's hand, drag to the left, tomahawk, boom, goal would have been scored. Their attempt at tying the game was interrupted as well. Okay, break for comments, and then we'll keep going into this. Okay. Tomas, if there was ever a VU, then game is it game over on referral? Okay, Tomas, this is an excellent question, and this is something that, I really like this question because I get to show off another video. You're absolutely right. Okay, so let me read it again. Gathering thoughts. If there was a video umpire, then game is over on referral. This is where I think the frustration comes from. One rule with a video umpire, then an inconsistent one without. Yeah, I can see that. So interestingly, I had a conversation with a member of the rules committee just a couple hours ago. And we talked about the times that we've seen this happen. And for this rules committee member, they were speaking about, I think, World Cup in 2013 or 2014, where this happened in a game. It happened at the Rio Olympics. It also happened at the Tokyo Olympics. I'm going to play the video and see what happens. I'm telling you, OBS, just leave me alone on this, okay? Just leave it. Because if I had been able to show this during the Tokyo Olympics in public, more people would have known about this rule and we wouldn't have this shit show that we did. Sorry. Because we talked about this on Talking Tokyo in the private Discord server and went through this because it was an unusual situation that you don't see very often. So I'm going to play the video, and if I need to cut it out later because I get a copyright strike, I'm going to then explain what we saw. And then I'll get back to Tomas's point. Okay, so this is the bronze medal game of the Olympics between India and Germany. It's the end of the first quarter. And my friend Kernsey here, he and I talked about this as well after the game. He blows his whistle, thinking that there had been a foul, and calls a penalty corner, and he's now getting advice from Simon, right there in the picture, saying, hey, it wasn't a foul. You can then hear Kernsey saying, oh, so it would have been a bully, but it has to be a restart, right? And he's, okay.
We'd normally have a bully. Penalty corner, we retake. Okay? Here, I shouldn't have. So it should be a bully restart. So is it penalty corner? Okay. I've blown it for too high, for dangerous. Okay.
So Adam is trying to explain to the Indian defenders what he did wrong in that, because he thought that was the first shot on the PC, mistakenly. When he realizes a mistake, he goes to Simon and says, that wasn't right. Oh, crap. Okay. He's interrupted the PC. The PC is not complete. Because a bully can't be awarded, it has to be another retake. And, I mean, if you think that under pressure, if that's not a pressurized situation, I don't know what is. Okay, so just in case I had to cut out the clip from the YouTube replay, very similar situation, but it's at the end of the first quarter of the bronze medal game between Germany and India. Germany attacking, India defending, and Adam has blown for what he thought was a dangerous ball. And what he means was that that was the first hit at goal and it would have been too high, but there had been a hit prior that had been blocked that counted as the first hit at net. So he blew his whistle too early. There was no foul by anybody. And he restarted with a penalty corner. As it turns out, no goal was scored on that play. And it went away. And you can see the difference that a management relationship has on that situation, where he's able to quietly but clearly explain to two teams who have varying levels of English comprehension what the rule is. And because of his respect capital that he's built up with these players, he's able to handle the situation. Okay, now Tomas, as you asked, if there was a video umpire, the game would have been over on referral. And what he means by that is, let's just say that Adam sticks to his guns and he says, no, I still think that was the first hit on the PC and therefore was dangerously high. And therefore it's a free hit out. India could have referred that decision. They would have won. And then they would have been awarded a free hit. And then another penalty corner wouldn't have been played. That's the difference that video referral makes. And like Tomas indicated, there is definitely an inconsistency there in a lot of ways. Okay. And part of that, again, is because the rules committee has decided it's important to have consistency in result with very little subjective room as to how to apply video umpire regulations. that teams will know the result. And if they win their appeal, they get a free hit. Do I think that's right? It makes sense in that context, but it also doesn't make sense in the other context. Because again, the attackers did nothing wrong. And their opportunity is taken away. Scott, it doesn't mention bullies. A bully doesn't complete a PC and PCs must be completed. Didn't this make the old rule guidance a little bit redundant? Yes, it did. And I think that was the thinking, Scott, behind the rules committee taking that guidance out. They're like, well, we don't really need it in these two places, right? Well, hold my beer. Hold my English breakfast blend. Aline, this is going to be insane. It's crazy. Be aware, guys, if you haven't seen it yet. Okay. The defenders did do something wrong. The offense of the original PC. Thank you, Scott. That scenario hasn't been played out or completed yet. Exactly. Exactly. Just because you're right that the umpire made a mistake doesn't mean that you've successfully defended a penalty corner. You haven't. Unfortunately, it's just not there. Goddard's, one of the interesting points would have been that the ball had come off the hand and gone quickly off, say, the baseline. Yes. And that's why I wanted to see the full scenario, because I wanted to fully understand the emotions of the players and be as in tune with that as I could. But as you saw, yeah, that bigger sense of injustice wasn't quite there. They were right to be clear. Yurian, in that case, the umpire would have blown after the ball crossed the baseline. Would it still be a retake? I think, you ready for me going out on a limb here? I believe that the penalty corner would have been completed, because it's the same thing with the video referral, okay? So this principle applies with the video referral in that if the ball has gone out of bounds, that decision replaces what would be a free hit in that case. So oftentimes with a video referral, the ball is still in play and the team's going, PC, 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 we want it. Mm-mm-mm. And then you do the whole thing. And you don't know how to restart play. But if the ball has gone out of bounds, you have that grounds to go back. So let me just pull up that 13.5 again. Sorry, there's that. There we go. So the ball has been played over the back line and a penalty corner is not awarded. So we do have a provision there. And I think that argument is sound. Take me on. Fight me. I usually say fight me when I'm like, you have no chance, but you have a chance here. If I've missed something in the logic, I want to hear about it, but I believe it's over at that point. And that, again, I think Goddard's ties back into what you were talking about, that sense of injustice, is that this eliminates that sense of injustice. And yeah, now that I'm sort of playing through it, had the ball been cleared out more than 5 meters outside the circle before the penalty corner was called again, then you go back to that. You go back to that. It's 13.5 sub C, and then you're good. And then the penalty corner is over, and boom. It's because he blew it so quickly, because he was quite convinced. He was quite convinced that he had made the right decision there. Okay. Yeah. Let's see. Okay. Since I'm behind the comments, you guys may have already sussed this out yourselves. Like, I'm late. It's fine. The umpire can make a decision after time for an event that has occurred before time has expired. Yes. Okay. That's the last part we're going to get to. Let me just star this if we had to get back. Okay. Irian, but right, if the umpires had concluded that no foul occurred, the PC would have ended by the ball going over the baseline. The call didn't interrupt the PC. It ended by, yes, exactly. Irian, very, thank you. I like the way you described that, and you made me sound correct. So thank you. But, says Simon Milford, if the umpires agree that a mistake decision was before the ball went out of play, yes, sure. Surely the restart of the PC has to apply. Yes, that's correct. And Rachel, if the foul is called for the foot, even though the ball has gone off the back line, that should be the decision. Okay, I think you're saying the same thing. Okay, now let's get back to what Goddard said here about changing minds. And this is, you know, and this is the part of the article, and this is the kind of stuff that just drives me crazy. Is, again, you can't change your mind, the game is over. Incorrect. Do not pass go. Do not collect $2,000, $200, whatever. Disconnect his buzzer. He is not allowed to speak anymore. Because that isn't the rule either. Here is the rule that we are going to finally address as well, is 5.1. Oh, I can't see this at all. Somebody read this aloud to me. If an incident arises immediately before the end of a quarter which requires review by the umpires, the review may be conducted even though the time has subsequently been completed and signaled. The review should take place immediately and action taken to revert to and correct the situation as appropriate. Ladies and gentlemen, end of story. I mean, that's just, it's as clear as that. I did a Ruly Tuesday, and I'm looking for my overlay. Where is my overlay for that? Ruly Tuesday. Let's see if this works. Nope. If I do it like this. Okay, just talk amongst yourselves while I experiment. It's going to be fine. RT004. Okay. And save. Add. There it is. Okay. Hop this in here. I also have it linked in the description of the YouTube video. This is where I did a Ruly Tuesday with really, really bad sounded audio. Don't bust my chops about that. About an incident, a few incidents, but I particularly remember Shaud Marini being very upset after an India-Malaysia game, and his players walked off the pitch and refused to play the rest of it. Sure, it was a friendly, but the Malaysian coach was very generous and just saying, fine, go ahead. For precisely this kind of scenario. Precisely this scenario. So we've talked about this. Like we, but again, when I have sympathy for players who say, you know, that rule rarely comes up. It's hard to know. But at the same time, friends, these are professionals. Unlike all of us, they get paid to play this game and to win at this game. Knowing the rules kind of might be part of that job description. At least to the point that if the rule is explained to you, you immediately say, oh, I'd forgotten about that one. I got it. Okay. So here am I, just a girl sitting on a live stream, wondering when the player who very respectfully asked her question, she absolutely did. There was nothing wrong with this painting of the scenario. Today, look, you know, it's not, there's nothing right here that should get our backs up and get all defensive about it. But this is an opportunity right here for a player to say, I started a discussion. I asked a legitimate question. I got a legitimate answer. Thank you for that answer. I now understand these rules better. I'm waiting. Like, I'm here for this. Is it going to happen? No. And that's the frustration that umpires have with these, just one of them, just one of these frustrations we have with these kinds of conversations is that we say, all right, we're here. We'll make ourselves vulnerable. We'll put our reputations out there. We'll risk being wrong when we explain things. We will risk the ridicule and the criticism that comes from making the mistake in the first place and admitting that we made the mistake in the first place. We'll do all that. And then we'll do the work to explain something. And then so that's where we're at. Any further questions on that? Because we are about to announce the Pibworth rule. Okay, let's see. Where are we at? Do. And I think it's fair to say, Michael, that it's one thing to do an umpire course, but it's another thing to spend a little bit more time in those shoes. And I talked about this on previous shows in the last few weeks because of my recent experience coaching the University of Calgary team in the Canada West season, where in my position as the assistant coach and my head coach, I kind of know what I'm doing in this whole rules sphere. I know a thing or two about a thing or two. Heather's as my head coach, she's a regionally certified umpire, very good umpire, who I've worked with at tournaments, and I've, you know, been her umpire manager. She knows a thing or two about a thing or two. And we were very, very clear with our players. We didn't have to spend a lot of time on the topic, but we were very clear with the players. At the beginning of the season, we said, you are going to have some amazing umpires. This is great news because now you don't have to worry about a thing. If they get something wrong that actually is material, don't you worry. You've got me, you've got Heather. And we will help. We will let you know if something needs to be discussed. And there was something, like the one time I said something on the pitch, and I believe I did it in a constructive tone of voice, but I did yell out, that's the incorrect decision. When a player injects the ball before the whistle has blown on a penalty corner, that player has to go to the center line because that's an early break. So I think I said all those words too. I'm a very verbose, argumentative coach. That was the only thing. Did I get the result I wanted? I didn't. In the end of the, it didn't really matter. It wasn't a big deal. But it was like, hey, that's actually an incorrectly applied rule. For everything else, it's like, well, it could have been a foot. Maybe it wasn't. I don't know. I got this vantage point. They've got that vantage point. I understand what it's like to be an umpire, and I understand what I can't see as a coach from the sideline. And I feel like I don't think you have to dedicate the last 20 years of your life to be an umpire coach the way that I have in order to understand the rules that, like, you don't have to be at that level of rules understanding, but you have to be at some level. Maybe. And then there's the whole issue about how you as a leader on your team manage the emotions of your players. And how do you process, how do you present information to them? How do you manage their emotions so that if that happens, maybe they go out and they defend that second corner and they do it successfully instead of them being so upset that they have to do it again. Professional coaches should know. Take the example of American football where time critical plays abound. Yeah, coaches, they know because it's the difference between winning and losing. And knowing that rule could have been the difference between winning and losing. It kind of was, except they couldn't change it. They couldn't manipulate the rule, or they couldn't make a different strategic decision in order to take advantage of it. But yeah, they kind of needed to know the rule. Okay, So I think I've completely demolished this topic. And I hope it helps. I hope that you've gotten to this point. Let's go back to the point that Paul made way back. Look at this. Found it. Because I'm a professional. Don't try this at home. Would it have been better if the controlling umpire had called the captains over to explain before signaling? Okay. There's another article that I've linked that came out today, I believe. Yeah, November 3rd. Yeah, it's today. And, oh, what the hell? Let me do a quick screen share overlay. New screen share overlay. Cool. No, that's not working out very well because I have other things that are locked. And I have so many things on here. Okay. Oh, yeah. I'm just going to sit here with this thing on my face. Whatever. It's fine. Oh, no. Okay. I can't do it. You just go click on the link and you read it yourself. Not right now. You're in the middle of a live stream. You got things to do. But a really nice article on hockey.nl. Again, the most controversial corner of the year through the eyes of the referee. And so it's an interview with Barry. Barry Van Bentham, only 24 years old. Bless. Center of attention on Sundays, on Sunday at Victoria's playout corner. So that's a term I think they have, you know, it's kind of like their equivalent of extra time. The playout corner, I saw it over and over again and all that kind of thing. So here's this, just a newly promoted umpire, hasn't been in the hoofed class for very long, and he explains his perspective of everything that happens. And here's the thing. He says, okay, after all, the final whistle had already sounded. He says, quote unquote, shit. I should have reported a bully. I'll think of that in 20 seconds. So I remembered it in about 20 seconds. I consult with Armand again. We know something has to be done. According to the rules, a corner cannot end in a bully. He thinks of a game's rules test, which took place before the season. It was a similar situation, so I knew pretty quickly what the rule was. If a bully follows from a corner, the corner must be retaken. Of course, I was disappointed with the situation on the field, especially communication. So there was no other solution. I should have never given that free ball, he says. So he mentions, and this is where it comes into our strategy when we deal with big things like this. Time is stopped. The game is over. And as Barry says in the article, take your time. Because if you don't rush into the next thing and you process, you talk it through with your colleague. Here's the first thing that happened. Here's the next thing that happened. What's the next step? Are we sure? Okay. And then he says, that's a learning point, and we should have communicated the final decision that the corner had to be taken again to the captains first. So, Paul, you are absolutely right. And we talk about this quite often after these big melees and big important decisions and things like that, of how bringing the captains, and in this case, bringing them both in is a really good idea, bringing them in and communicating it clearly to them first so they can manage the emotions of their teams. It's not your job. You can't take that on. It's too hard. It's just too hard. You can't manage the coach. You can't manage the physical trainer from Australia who thinks he knows what the rules are. It's not your job to manage all those people, but you take on the consequences of that if you don't manage the two people that you do have that special relationship with. So absolutely talking to the captains first in that instance would have really, really helped get that situation. And it's all about, you think, okay, we figured it out, corner, right? And you just kind of react. Because you want to alleviate the pressure on yourself as soon as possible. You want to escape valve, whoosh, you know, let everything go. You got to keep it in a little bit. And think about, it's like a slow cooker. Or no, the opposite. I'm like looking behind me because I'm thinking about my kitchen and how we have is it the crock pot? The steam pressure cooker thing, and you got to let out the pressure. The pressure's got to get let out slowly at first, because if you let all of it out at once by signaling that PC and signaling your decision, it's like, poof, and then everything explodes in the emotion, blah, blah, blah. I think you understand the point. The first crockpot analogy in umpiring. Yeah, there we go. Oops, I missed something here. Stefan, you agree with Goddard's. It's the individual responsibility. Need to do the work. Do the work. Do the work. I'm right here, coaches, players, everybody. And there are people in the world. I get WhatsApp messages all times of day and night from coaches all around the world who are like, they send me their clips and they say, I need to explain this to my players. Tell me what I should tell them. Can you help me understand it? How do I process this? And they're looking for guidance. They're looking for knowledge. They're looking at ways that they can learn better so that they can handle and manage their players better. And I freaking love it. I absolutely it's like, yes, this is what we're living for, because this can make a difference. This isn't me just telling umpires. I can change the culture of entire communities of hockey players by having one relationship with one coach in South Africa and one relationship with a coach in Chile and all kinds of stuff, right? So those things just absolutely, I would put these coaches on a speed dial where they can wake me up at 4 a.m. and I'd be like, yeah, let's do this. This is so exciting. We're here and you are out there in your communities and you are available for this. And we have to get better at this. We have to. Simon, wash your mouth out with soap. But it's the only good thing about that sport. Basketball. Basketball is very similar too. And it's interesting because these are sports that maybe some of us, these are forms of sport ball that we don't like. Us hockey people, we think the games are ridiculously technical and the rule books are like super, super long. And that's the irony. Is that the rule books are super, super long and complicated in both of those sports. Baseball, hugely long. And yet, these coaches know them better than our coaches. 15 rules. 15 rules. That's it. And they don't know them. And yes, we can. Yes, and the experience is there. And what I want to say in terms of sort of mitigating that and showing some empathy is, it's not like this happens every day. And it understanding how to process and having the skill set and having made the mistake that this umpire did, Barry, he's never going to do that again. He's never going to do that again. And he'll get many more opportunities because all of us have made these mistakes. All of us have had matches where we didn't handle those key moments properly. And the reason that you and I are sitting down right now and we're having this private conversation, just you and I, is because we are trying to make it more possible for you to skip that mistake. Or if you make that mistake, you only do it once. And you never do it again. And I wish for every umpire, I think back on my career and all the mistakes that I had to make because I was so ignorant of everything. That's why I'm here, is so that you don't have to be in that position. Yeah. Okay, stop fighting you two about American football. We don't care about sportball. Bill Polschek is a role model of mine as a coach. Great book by him. Results take care of themselves. Very interesting. I've been very intrigued by this whole coaching philosophy of emphasizing the process. If you've listened to any GB athlete over the last 2 years, that's all they talk about. And it's like to the point of nausea, talking about how important the process is and following that and all that kind of stuff. And I think every coach should coach an official. They should coach an umpire. So we were going into, I don't know, game seven of our 8-game season, and Heather turned to me on the bench after I'd had some exchanges with a couple of players, and she said, "Keely, I don't get how you are so positive with players. Like, how, because your personality, you know, okay, look, I can be a little, you know, I have feelings. I feel a certain way about certain things. But the one thing that I've, the one skill that I have honed over the last 20 years is working with a group of people who never get to win. You want to learn how to focus on the journey and on growth and progress and how to celebrate the great things that people do in bettering themselves? Coach an umpire. That is truly taking the result out of sport. And now it just comes naturally to me. And when I'm on the sideline with a team that I'm coaching, and I am jumping up and down because somebody has executed a flipper pass into space, into the, you know, corner of the field the way that we've been training, and they finally do it a game, it's like we've scored a goal. And that's what I'm like when I coach umpires. When I see umpires doing something that we've trained, we've talked about, I'm like, I want to scream. It's very exciting. So that's what I would say. I wonder if Bill Pulschek was ever worked with officials, because that's a great way you can get it. Scott, we can definitely learn from cooking. I guess so. Pressure cooker situation. Yes. Yes, I know it's a very well-known saying, but it's just funny because I'm just visualizing my, you know, over there, it sits by the ostrich lamp, and when we do race. Anyway. Oh, goodness. Okay. Luke, it's 2:08 and it's time to get onto the Pibworth rule. Now, we kind of alluded to it when I was reading out the translated interview with Barry. So please do go read that. And I want you to read specifically what he talks about when he's going through the process of the rule, because there is something that completely missed my attention. And when I spoke to the member of the rules committee today, this person thought, wow, didn't realize that happened in January 2021. And this was brought to our attention in our huddle on Monday. So if you haven't been to a huddle and you're a yellow member, who are you? Because you're missing some good stuff. Because Luke Pibworth nailed it. He absolutely dropped a truth bomb when he said, wait a minute, the way that the rules now read as of January, it's not just end of time PCs that can't end in bullies. It's all of them, according to how the rule was written. So let's go back to that, just so we can reinforce all these things and everybody knows. Okay, oops. See, there's my Ruly Tuesday joining up. Oh, there it was. See, there's the one that I made before that I couldn't find because pressure. So, in case of the award of a bully at a penalty corner without any of the conditions of 13.5, A to F not being completed, the corner is retaken. There is no mention in 13.5 anymore about end of time. And this, my friends, is what Luke Pibworth noticed. brought to my attention, and I brought it to a person who is now a person on the rules committee. And the question is now, was this an intentional choice? Or was it a side effect, unintended, of the way that things were deleted and added into the rule book? So as we said before, and I think it was Stefan or it was Scott who said that, well, it was redundant, so you could take it out. But in taking it out, you remove the connection to the end of time issue. And now it's not there. So, Luke, good work. You uncovered something that at least I hadn't noticed, and nobody else I've spoken to noticed. I think the KNHB did notice it, because of the way that Barry phrased his responses in his interview. He said, just hang on a sec. Let me make sure. He thinks of the games rules test. It was a similar situation. I knew pretty quickly what the rule was. If a bully follows from a corner, that corner must be retaken. He doesn't say if a bully follows from a corner that is happening in extra time or play out situation, as they call it. He doesn't say that. He just says if a bully follows from a corner, the corner must be retaken. They knew. So there you go. Let's see. I'm going to go back to some comments and see how y'all are doing with that. That blew my mind. And if it didn't blow your mind, well, you're a better rules reader than I. COVID, I'm going to blame for this egregious error. And if you've been following me for a while, you know that every time a new rules book comes out, I do a line-by-line comparison. Line-by-line, I go through and I write a silly little blog, really long blog post, where I go through the line-by-line comparison and try to help suss out why things have changed and what effect it has on the way that we're going to umpire certain scenarios. And I didn't do it in November 2020. I didn't do it in January 2021 because I was like, well, they're just cleaning up a couple things. I don't have to do a line by line and really think about very carefully. I am ashamed. Luke, thank you for being a hero. And Godders is going back to Liz's promotion. Yes. Excellent. Stefan, my daughter plays softball, and man, the knowledge needed with the rules is significant. Lots of debates happen, players, coaches, and officials. All together, right? All together. They're there. Every press conference after they say, yeah, definitely, all they talk about is process and expression. Very interesting. Oh, and you're talking about the All Blacks. Yes. Okay, so you're back to the point about focusing on process and, yep, and who you are as a person, who you're growing into as a player. I feel that. Great spot. Hello, sir. Good to see you. Yep. So this is sort of the central question here that a lot of people just can't wrap their heads around as to how this could possibly be fair. If the team defending hasn't done anything wrong, how can it be fair that they have to defend it again? Well, they get to defend it again. So that's a good part. But the attackers also don't lose their opportunity to attack that penalty corner. So, yeah, now that we've worked through that other stuff, Scott, I'm absolutely convinced. Absolutely convinced. Thank you for helping me along with that thought process. Oh, and that's the other message, right? And I think, you know, we talk a lot about being decisive and whistle timing and making big decisions quickly, but sometimes you have the opportunity to go back and fix a missed penalty corner decision more easily than you do incorrectly calling a penalty corner. And that is why we have pre-match chats with our colleague where we agree, how are we going to handle this? If it needs to be a free hit out and you see it, that needs to happen right away, because the mess that'll happen if we don't make that decision quickly can be just devastating for the presentation of the result. It can be unsafe. It can be all kinds of things. So you might in your pre-match chat say, if I've missed a free hit out and you have a great position and you're absolutely certain, I just want you to blow it. Scandal. But that's a talk I have with my colleagues, because I'm more interested in things being done correctly. I'm more interested in players trusting us, and I'm more interested in their safety. When it comes to the penalty corner, you can let it play out. You can let it go off the baseline. You can let it go out, and then your colleague can say, PC, PC, there was a foot, and give you the advice as to what you missed, and you can go back and fix it afterwards. Very important. Get in your flowers, Luke. I hope you're embarrassed. I hope you're feeling like, not embarrassed. I hope you're blushing. I hope you're blushing. And I did inform the person that I was speaking with at the Rules Committee that it wasn't my discovery, and I mentioned your name, just so you know. Programmer humor, this change is so minor. It certainly has no side effects. Okay, that is exactly what happened here. The fact that such a small change suddenly turns out to have such a side effect is very recognizable as an IT person. It's very recognizable as anybody who's got a legal background like I do. And the person I was speaking with also has that same background. And we were like, yeah, dang. Okay, she wasn't like that because she's not North American. So opportunities are what matters. It's why we balance the scales of justice with penalties. Well said, sir. Well said. Very well done. Another nail in the coffin of the bully. I know. Yes. Yes. Get out of here. You suck. Oops. Missing a semicolon, for example. Rachel does know. It may be in the rules for a while before the next review. Actually, no. So if it stays, like, yes. But the next review of this is happening very soon. And by very soon, I mean like very soon. We do know that the next rules of hockey will be issued in, should be issued for January 2022. Because it happens immediately, or it happens 6 months after the Olympics, 6 months after the World Cup. Or a couple months. Anyway, it happens in the January after the one of the two major world tier events. Hartmut, how could you be late for this one? Oh, that's what I say. You're late because of an umpire's online session with your German colleagues. Nevertheless, thank you. Good to see you anyway. You're going to have to watch this replay because, I mean, I enjoyed it. It was really fun for me. It is 2:19. Okay, do we want to try to sneak in a scenario? I said it was going to be a thing. Just outdoor, not indoor, I assume. Oh, man. Do I have to go look at the indoor rules for this now? Look, I just wrapped my head around this. Yeah, I'm going to have to go look. Great question, AJ, because next week we're going to start with some indoor stuff because you guys are getting ready. Y'all are getting ready. Europe will be playing. Hey, we've had three weeks of indoor in Calgary. So I had a very good weekend with my club. The team that I'm a player coach for, we won 5-1. And then my ones who I coach, we won 9-1. It was a good weekend. I don't know how the threes did yet. I haven't heard. If I knew your middle name, sir. Luke Jonathan Pibworth. How very dare you be so smart. No, I really appreciate it. And yes, I know that there are probably lots of people in the world who knew this before our community discovered it. But this is the thing. This is kind of, this is the immense power and responsibility that I have. No. Is that I'm going to make a Ruly Tuesday about this as soon as I get the go-ahead to do so. Because this has to be explained and this has to get out there. And it's going to be my first comeback Ruly Tuesday. Welcome to 6.5. Let's talk about it. 6.5/13.5. But I want to make sure triple, quadruple, quintuplet, sextuple nations, definitely that it's absolutely true. And we're coming up on Monday. There you go. It's David. Luke David Pitworth. Okay. Oh, I hope you do get some indoor in a couple months too. That'll be awesome. Okay. 10 minutes. Let's do two scenarios. This one was sent to me by Joe Waddy on the Instagrams. In the very next passage of play, card shorty flick. Oh. Okay, first of all, this account is disqualified for using two terms that do not apply in hockey. There's no such thing as a shorty, and there's no such thing as a flick. Just shutting that one down. Okay. Oh, that should be looping. Here, let me just loop it. Loop this thing around. And no, it doesn't seem to be playing at all. Let's try this. And try this. Let's see if it loops this time. Okay. Let me know what you think. I'll just wait. Oh, this is really weird. It is looping, but it won't replay every time. I don't know how many times you have to see it because it's pretty clear. It's a penalty stroke and a 5-minute yell at least. Depends on what else has happened in the game, but yeah, it's just... That's not hard. Anybody disagree with me? No? Okay, let's go to the next one. I'm just kidding. I'll just wait for some more comments. Yes, definitely a penalty stroke loop. Lou, and, okay, and a yellow card. Absolutely. Yep, stroke and a yellow, says Gideon. Correct, sir. Correct. Correct, and... Okay. Always be thinking about how... Okay, I'm going to try to... Hey, there you go. Lou. He's like, I got it. I'm in there. Where did I put it? Okay. So remember this part from the FIH International Briefing, which is going to be updated very soon, but they have to meet first, is that a 5-minute yellow card offense is a physical foul with body or stick, including off the ball incidents. Okay, so that is distinguished from a green card offense, and why you wouldn't give a green card for that, because a green card is just off the ball minor physical offenses like pushing or holding at a free hit, breakdown of play with low impact or by deliberate use of feet, body, or stick. So a green card offense lacks that physical dangerous element. As soon as you're wiping somebody out, that is a yellow card offense. AJ, yellow card for not wearing a smock that is a significantly different color to the field players. Okay. I mean, you're right, but that's a technical issue that for which no foul or personal penalty can be applied. You simply have to prevent that from happening. Okay, here's the other one. That was like the fastest scenario I've ever processed. Let's look at this one. I've turned off the sound because it's just music. But this one is quite interesting, and a penalty stroke is awarded for this collision. I'd like to hear your thoughts. So this one was also on another forum on the social medias. And most people were getting it right, but it was still a little concerning about the voices who were getting it so incredibly wrong. So incredibly wrong. Free Hit Defense says, AJ Godders, I know you're talking about the last one. AJ, Free Hit Defense, no penalty stroke. Field, Free Hit Defense, goalie was stationary. Free Hit Defense, I mean, boy, yup. Good job, buddy. You're fine. Don't worry about it. When we get things wrong or it's a much more ambiguous situation, like don't worry about it. We're here to learn. No penalty stroke, free hit defense. Free hit defense for obstruction, overrunning the goalkeeper. Tricky. Yeah, kind of tricky, but free hit defense from Stefan, free hit from Rachel. Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to go, I'll kind of freeze and go back and forth over this section. And then I want to talk about a couple things with this. Okay, here's the replay of this. Now, we have talked about this. Remember the time at Bandcamp when we said to uncover the truth behind a potential obstruction, which this is. It's just two players come together in an obstructive way. Stop looking at the attacker and look at what the defender does. And if the defender doesn't do anything wrong and the result is a big collision, a big clattering sound, they're not the ones who did it. They're not to blame. So in this particular situation, I look at the goalkeeper who is stationary, is not moving laterally by any stretch that I can see. Very little forward movement. The ball, I mean, the goalkeeper kicks out the left kicker towards the ball, makes a save. So if you watch the goalkeeper, nothing happened. Okay. One of the other things that I was a little bit dismayed at from some of the comments from people who got this wrong on the socials was somebody said, well, the umpire was in a great position. No, he wasn't. The umpire was well behind the play. He makes the call from just inside the circle. That isn't a great position. And when you look at where that play came from, my concern would be, okay, and we talk about this in mission critical positioning in the course that I run, starting position, like, why are you out there? Why are you that wide? Why are you that high up the pitch? Such that when the ball does break, and look at the running pattern, he's actually running toward the sideline so he can make a really long J cut and lose track of the faster players who are out running behind him. And it's just, it's not good positioning. Doesn't give him the best opportunity to see and to focus on the movement of the goalkeeper. From that angle, he can't see as well. And that's where the mistake comes. Okay? So those are the things that I would focus on. The reason why we talk about mission critical positioning so much is because those are the big calls. That's a stroke. That's a very, very good chance at a goal. Those are your biggest calls. Who cares what's happening in the middle of the pitch? I mean, we do, but we really care about those calls, and you have to be there to get them right. And that's not getting it right. Okay? No big deal. You know, it's sport. But let's put those pieces together so that we can make a better decision. get in a position where you can see the movement of the defender and you can correctly assign the initiation of movement and who does what so that you can get to your best, most correct decision. Okay. Thanks, Rachel, for the preview. I'll be looking at that. Everybody sign up. Yes, thank you, Simon. Please do hit the like button if you like what you've had today. It has been a Keely hour. Let's see, play on. Good channel for defense to clear. Yeah, okay. So that's actually an interesting little side conversation. And I guess part of it is that I actually have a habit of doing this all the time. When I see a goalkeeper getting collided with or something like that, but you have a lot of room that you can play advantage for the defense for, it's a fairly rare situation, but you're absolutely right, Simon. There is a good opportunity for advantage there. You could play on. You have to really communicate that because you've had a collision. That goalkeeper needs to know that you saw what happened to them and that you're not going to let anything, like, they are not going to be vulnerable for another shot. You're like, yep, I saw that. We're playing on. I got you. You okay? You okay? You know, you get that contact, establish that rapport, let them know that you are there and you understand. Okay. And I think it's important that it's not just a play on. It's an advantage. Get that arm up. Go on. Okay. Go on. Try it. Don't be like this. No foul, because a goalkeeper will be on the ground going, what? I just got smoked. But they'll be happy if something good happens and their teammates are able to take the ball up the pitch and do something awesome. Okay. So think about it that way. You're very welcome. It was a great evening. I really appreciate it. It was so good. Oh! What? Rachel with the pun of the night. Should it be the Luke button? Oh my goodness. We have to be so careful not to be biased against keepers. Okay, don't use the word bias. We have to be careful to properly assess keepers' motions and what fouls they may or may not be committing when people are going to ground. Absolutely. And some of the, and I totally missed it, that some of the discussion that I've seen, and it's important to point out, the goalkeepers are supposed to go down in their circle. They are allowed to use their body. We expect them to go down. If that goalkeeper had taken even a more aggressive logging position and that attacker just like collided, fall over, boom, like massive, like, blah, stick goes flying, all that kind of stuff. It's kind of their job. It's their job to do that. And as long as she's not coming and cutting the space and clearly acting in a reckless manner, as long as that goalkeeper is just, I'm logging to make the best save I can right here without moving towards the attacker, bloody hell. It's a tricky play on if the goalkeeper's flattened, but if the ball turns over quickly and the goalkeeper's out of commission. Yes, that's a really good point, Gideon, and that's where the risk comes in. And that's why you really have to make contact with that player and you have to know exactly where they're at. If they're healthy enough to yell at you, then you know they're okay and you can play on. If you don't hear anything from them, then you've got another issue. You may have a potential head injury and you don't play advantage on head injuries, unfortunately. Okay. So very good point, Gideon. Thanks for pointing that out. And I hate it when keepers get pinged like this. Yeah, me too. I do too. I hate it when anybody gets pinged. Oh, I thought the same. Oh man. You are definitely sharing this episode, sir. Okay. Thank you all very much for your time, your contributions. It was so good to have you. So good to be back. So good to straighten out this whole shabazzle. I will be back with you to report upon what I have learned about the consequence of the re jigging of 6.5 and the subtraction of the subclause G in 13.5. We will talk about this later because it isn't a small thing. It's a little thing that makes the program potentially break. Okay. Thank you so much. Stain, I believe you want to share it with at everyone. You just blast it out there. I want everyone to see this. I hope it was good. And I will be, when I make the Ruler Tuesday, I'll be referring back to this episode and driving everybody to all the discussion. Because I don't know, can I do it in 8 minutes? Who knows? We'll see. Good to see you. Great session. Only a couple of mini rants. I was relatively restrained, wasn't I? You should have seen me a couple days ago. Good. I learned something too. And I learned something because of this person right here. Thank you. So glad to have you part of the FHU 13. Okay. Have a fantastic rest of your Wednesday. We will be back next week. Let's start talking some indoor. Okay. It's going to be fun. And send your comments, your ideas, your suggestions to me on the Discord server. Come join the Discord server. It's a really cool place to hang out. And I know it looks intimidating and it looks like all the cool kids are there, but as soon as they start using the acronyms that we don't understand, I get them to explain themselves. I also rule that place with an iron fist. Just ask anybody. Culture. I make sure that it's exactly a constructive experience and a good place for everybody to be. I hope. You think. Won't be as many goals in yours. No worries. Okay. Have a fantastic one. You guys are awesome. It was fun. Be good to yourselves and stay safe. Bye, everybody.